So thank you, all of you, for having me. My name is Efraim Meir, and I'm a professor emeritus in Jewish philosophy at Bar-Ilan University. So this is my home, my second home. And I'm going to talk about trans difference.
What is?
Now, the first question, of course, is what is this monstrous word mean? Trans difference, I will perhaps show you a picture and make it clear, even more clear than in words, what I mean with trans difference. Here is a picture of the Scandinavian artist Susanne Tornqvist. And this is a picture of Yosef, our brother. You know, it is written in the Torah that he has a ketonet pasim. So nobody knows exactly what it is, but it could be. It is frequently translated as a multicolored garment, whatever that means. So you see here the plurality of all kinds of people within the garment of Yosef, but there is a unity. The unity of the garment and the difference of all the people who are represented in the garment. So we have unity and diversity. We have differences which are honored, respected, but at the same time, there is a kind of bridging, kind of communication, notwithstanding the differences, but thanks to the differences. Because if there are differences, we can enrich ourselves by lifestyles of religious others. We can learn about them, from them, and we can be a host in their houses of religious others. We can extend hospitality to religious others. We can translate their words or their worlds in our words, which is an act of peace. If you can do that, that could be really a messianic thing, meaning a liberating experience. So I'm going to talk about a trans difference. You know now, all of you, what is trans difference? There are now two options. Or I stop talking because you know everything, or, and I suggest I will do that, take the second option, which is reading what I prepared. Okay, so here I go. My lecture deals with the contribution of modern Jewish dialogical thinkers to interreligious dialogue and theology. I describe how Buber, Rosenzweig, Heschel, and Levinas contributed to the Jewish-Christian dialogue and broader to an interreligious theology from a Jewish vantage point. Interreligious theology is a new kind of theology that accepts and celebrates plurality in religiosities and is grounded in dialogical praxis. Whereas confessional theology is the reflection upon one's own religion, interreligious theology investigates the conditions for an interreligious dialogue in which partners learn from each other and appreciate each other. It is therefore a novel way of relating to different religious groups in society. It admits that neither exclusivism, inclusivism, nor tolerance or pluralism are enough. It learns in bookless moments from and with people who live and think differently. Now, I have to add something autobiographically. I have also trans difference within me, because I know what is Christianity, I came from it, and I know a little bit about Judaism also. So, rather than operating with a fixed content, interreligious theology is open and contextual. In the emerging new discipline of dialogical theology, distinctness allows for communication. Interreligious theology investigates the incommensurability of religions as well as the comparability between them. It establishes connections through translations and creates bridges. It is prone to promote self-criticism and to stimulate creative interaction with others. In an increasingly global world, foreign religions quickly became neighbor religions. In such a constellation, it's imperative to recognize that people from other religions have their own access to what John Hick calls the ultimate reality. In the construction of a dialogical theology from a Jewish point of view, one may become inspired by dialogical elements in the Jewish sources. In the following, I focus upon the relevance of four Jewish philosophers for the construction of a dialogical theology and for the present-day Jewish-Christian dialogue. Let me start with Martin Buber. In his I and Thou, Ich und Du, 1923, Buber developed a transformative thinking in which the isolated self is a mere mental construct. As such, he belongs to a growing movement of relational thinking that contributes to the interreligious theology. He writes, I quote, "The I becomes I through the you, and in the beginning is relation. The relationship with God, the eternal Tao, takes place within the relationship with others." In the third part of Ich und Du, Buber points to the necessity of religions which all create, I quote, "a new form of God in the world, to the degree that they relate to their living source and force, the ever-present Tao." Religions are therefore necessary, but also problematic. They have a Janus face, since they belong to the it world as well as to the you world. Buber was a great critic of Gnostic-style religions, disconnected from the world and situated the relationship with God within the intersubjective meeting. Only through Gegenwärtigkeit, the presence, before the other, one receives a glimpse of the ever-present eternal Thou. Consequently, God is never an object of our thoughts, an it, but rather to be addressed as a you. Lowering God to an it has been the eternal problem of religions that want to possess God and make him permanently available. In religious, Buber asserts, one desires to have God. In contrast, he understood authentic religiosity as the real encounter with the eternal Tao as taking place in openness to the other human being. Faith and cult may degenerate and freeze the living, holistic I-Tao relationship into a relationship of lesser degree, the fragmentary I-It, relationship that occurs between the subject and the object. And firstly, thanks to the living actual relationship, cult and faith may turn again and again into presence. Buber's dialogical thoughts, as they come into the expression in I and Thou, are of crucial importance for interreligious theology, which values a presence that makes the other present without classifying and objectifying, functionalizing or admonishing. The sublime act of presence and the realization of a between person, Zwischenmensch, are cornerstones for the construction of an interreligious theology. For Buber, interhuman meetings do not take place when knowing or hearing about the other and its narrative. In the encounter, one speaks to the other, one talks with the other, one addresses him or her in openness. The problem is that one easily makes a caricature of the other instead of approaching him or her without bias and even without prior knowledge and concepts. If knowledge comes first, one misses a real meeting. In aimlessness, the marvel of meeting may take place. Dialogue is not a dispute or a debate, but entails affirming, not only accepting, the partner and approaching him or her as a you. In view of the fact that the interreligious dialogue is often burdened by a priori categories, biased attitudes, and reductive approaches, Buber's alternative to the problematic it world with its subject-object scheme is simply therapeutic. In his relation to other religions, Buber paid special attention to Christianity. He gave great weight to pre-Pauline Christianity and placed it alongside Judaism as an imminent way of serving God. He labeled it early pre-Pauline Christianity as radically Jewish. Moreover, he thought that as a Jew, he could understand Jesus better than Christians because of Jesus' Jewishness. In 1926, Buber founded the journal Die Kreatur, with the aim to create a genuine dialogue between the different religions that were defined as houses of exile. The title Die Kreatur was chosen because religions with different revelations have creation in common. In his non-exclusivist view, there was a plurality. The Church and Israel both knew about Israel, but they interpreted Israel in a fundamentally different way. A different polemic tone is perceivable in Buber's article The Face of Judaism, first published in 1933. In the article, Buber accuses John the Evangelist of having substituted the diet for the Jewish triad of creation, revelation, and redemption. John reduced revelation and redemption to one single time. Marcion, Paul's pupil, went even further by substituting a monad for the dyad. Creation was not God's work and no longer blessed. In Marcion's Gnostic view, the material world could no longer become God's kingdom. In modern times, the Marcionizing worldview was adopted by Arnulf von Harnack, who deemed that the entire Old Testament was the result of an ecclesiastical paralysis. In the catastrophic 1930s, Buber blamed people for turning a blind eye to the spirit of Judaism, which endeavored to bring redemption into the concrete, created world. In his first lecture upon his arrival in Jerusalem in 1938, Buber further explains his thesis. 3 years after von Harnack's death in 1930, Hitler realized the Marcionite thought, not with spiritual, but with violent physical needs. For Hitler, the Church had to make a choice to side with Judaism or to categorically distance herself from it. Buber linked the Christian antisemitism to Hitler's racial antisemitism. Although he severely criticizes Christianity, he resumed his dialogue with Christians also after World War II. Buber distinguished between Judaism and Christianity, but he deemed that in eschatological times, the exiles of the religions would be gathered in the kingdom of God. This eschatological perspective made religions relative and put them in the service of the kingdom of God, which should not be identified with only one religion. In this way, Buber built bridges between different religions. They were not the kingdom itself. Buber noted differences between Judaism and Christianity, but he developed what I call a transdifferent, here it comes, a transdifferent attitude. He believes in an interaction with Christians and hoped that they could see Jesus with new eyes and learn what had been neglected throughout the ages, that Jesus' context was the context of Jewish emunah. He wanted to teach Christians that Jesus could only be understood from his Jewish background. Jesus became for him the hyphen between two religions that needed each other. One religion could learn from the other. I deem that Buber's view on the positive interaction between the two religions is exemplary for the interreligious dialogue and theology. In his Zweiglaubensweisen, published in 1950, Buber did not believe in Jesus, but with the belief of Jesus. He placed Jesus in the history of Messianism and saw him as someone with messianic forces, as a suffering servant of the Lord, a messianic person who stepped out of hiddenness. With this perspective, he saw that he had created a common platform between Christians and Jews. He hoped that Jews would give a place to Jesus in the history of messianism and of the servants of the Lord. He admonished Christians to recognize that Jesus belonged to Judaism and that he could not be extracted from his most natural Sitzim Leben in favor of the invention of Christ as presented in Pauline theology and the Dogmata. At the same time, he disagreed with Jewish religious fundamentalists who did not want to hear about Jesus or Christianity. He believed that he had created a common ground between Christians and Jews. Jesus was his big brother, a person who had been completely within the Jewish tradition and had desired that people not forget the intention of their deeds and remember it to hallow each detail in everyday life. His Jesus was an anti-dualistic, anti-gnostic, like a Hasid, who allows every aspect of life and accentuates intention and interiority. He related to the world which had to be mended, Tikkun Olam, and brought to the kingdom of God. Buber wrote extensively about Jesus as an immanent dialogical person and a Jewish son of God. In his view, Jesus was a suffering servant, an Evet Hashem, as in Deutero Isaiah. He sincerely thought that his understanding of Jesus as a suffering servant could diminish Gnostic tendencies in Christianity. I appreciate very much Buber's view on the relationship between Judaism and Christianity, and I value his approach to Jesus as a suffering servant. However, the downside of Buber's view on Judaism and Christianity lies in his radical opposition, the radical opposition he portrays between the Jewish emunah, confidence, trust, and the Christian pistis, belief in, creed. In his typology, emunah is dominant in Judaism, whereas pistis rules in dogmatic Hellenistic Christianity. To a great extent, Buber's distinction between the Jewish emunah and the Hellenistic Gnostic pistis overlaps his distinction between I, you, and I, it in his Ich und Du. It further overlaps his opposition between religiosity or prophetic attitude and the religion or priestly organization, an opposition which he found in the Bible but which in fact reflects his own anti-institutional religious attitude. There have been prophetic, in my view, prophetic and priestly viewpoints in Judaism as well as in Christianity. For Buber, emunah is I-you language, pistis I-it. Critical of the growing I-it culture of his time, he deemed that this problem started with the Pauline view. Paul's impact would be tangible in the society of Buber's day. Paul objectivized and created a dogma instead of continuing a religion in which the tshuva, return or answer, is central. In his attention to religion as linked to the concrete secular world, Buber severely criticized Paul, who was made responsible for the growth of the I-it culture. Paulinism was palpable whenever one relinquished a forever unredeemed and unredeemable world. In his own religious socialism, Buber linked religiosity to the concrete world, faithful to the Jewish idea of Tikkun Olam. He contested the dichotomy between religiosity and secularity. With this contrast between pistis and emunah, Buber rephrased his philosophical categories of ayat and ayu and applied them to the religious domain. The problem is that by this application of his philosophical categories, Christianity belongs largely to the it world, deprived of the salvific you world. Through his approach to Jesus, Buber inspired many, many Christians. He described Jesus as a messianic person who called for tshuva. Jesus had a faith that expressed itself in deeds, but placed the emphasis upon one's interiority, upon the way one performs the mitzvot, commandments. In this manner, Buber purified Jesus from the dogmatic garments in which he was dressed by his followers in later stages. In the same way as Buber, David Flusser tried in his historical research to understand Jesus from his Jewish origins. Buber and Flusser, each in his own way, thereby laid foundations for a fruitful and challenging dialogue between Judaism and Christianity. From the standpoint of interreligious theology, this is a great contribution. A very Jewish Jesus, a kind of tzaddik, connected to and responsible for others, rejoicing and suffering with them, became the link between Judaism and Christianity. Buber invited Jews and Christians to truly meet each other in dialogues without preconceived agendas. Both had their own way to God and had to testify to his presence, to God's presence, through meetings in this concrete world. Alongside Buber's contribution to the interreligious dialogue and dialogical theology, I note also some flaws in Buber's writing on religions. First of all, post-Pauline Christianity is not devoid of deeds. It is therefore questionable if one may typologically reserve the existential attitude of Emunah for Judaism and divest Christianity of it. The holistic I-you as well as the fragmentary or functional I-it are present in Judaism and in Christianity. Buber's distinction does not acknowledge a more complex reality. Notwithstanding his own remark in the beginning of his Zwei Glaubensweisen, he remains apologetic. Second, it is positive that Buber situates Jesus completely in the history of Jewish faith. He hereby challenges Christians to understand Jesus differently from his Jewish life setting in the tradition of Emunah. He wanted Christians to leave their attitude of pistς and return to the tradition of Emunah. But was he right in contrasting Jesus with Paul? In the new view on Paul, from a Jewish standpoint, Paul is no longer the founder of a new religion. He is rather the religious genius who extended the divine alliance from the Jewish people to the entire spectrum of the nations of the world. Third, it's quite understandable that after the Shoah, Buber blames Christianity for its anti-Judaism, its exclusivism, and its purely Christian prototypical interpretation of the Hebrew Bible. But in his laudable effort to understand primitive Christianity as a pure and radical Judaism, he did not, in my eyes, sufficiently value the specificity of Christianity as a world religion, which has its roots in Judaism and at the same time enlarges Judaism's horizon to the entire world. However, Buber knew that Jews and Christians had each their own way of talking about the divine mystery, and this may lead to mutual understanding. In the renewal of their respective faiths, Israel and the Church had much to say to each other that had not yet been said, and in this manner they could help each other. Another point of criticism concerns Buber's view on apocalyptic elements in Judaism and Christianity. I will skip that because finally it's my view that Judaism and Christianity are threatened by a dichotomy between the secular and the religious, between world and spirit, between faith and deeds, and both are called to redeem an unredeemed world, to make the tikkun olam possible, and it's not so that apocalyptic views are in Christianity and anti-apocalyptic views in Judaism, that is too simplistic. I deem that Buber's Zwei Glaubensweisen in 1950, compared with I and Du, 1923, is a regression although an understandable one after the sad anti-Jewish history of Christians that culminated in the Shoah. With this book, Buber offered the reader his own analysis of the crisis of Western civilization, which was much influenced by a kind of Christian gnosis. In Zweiglaubensweise, Buber fulminated against God gnosis. He attests that Christians need the Old Testament and may understand themselves better on the background of the Tanakh. With his anti-gnostic thoughts, Buber wanted to save Christianity from a false religiosity that was not linked to daily life in the concrete world by Tikkun Olam. Yet, the means he used in order to reach his goal are, in my view, problematic. Today, new Jewish views on Jesus and Paul have arisen among American Jewish scholars. Zalman Shachter Shalomi and Daniel Maat are not interested in the historical or ethical Jesus or in his messianism. They accept Christian claims of incarnation prima facie. They positively evaluate Jesus, including in his more transcendent aspect. Of further importance for the Jewish-Christian dialogue is the so-called New Perspective on Paul, which maintains that Paul did not oppose nomos and pistis. Mark Nanos, for instance, maintains that Paul saw himself entirely within Judaism, that he was not the founder of a new religion, but a reformer who fought against Jewish ethnocentrism and considered the non-Jewish converts as full members of the family of Abraham and not merely guests. Non-Jews could participate in the covenant without having to observe the mitzvot, which are boundary makers. The new perspective on Paul allows for more continuity between Jesus and Paul. The dividing line between Judaism and Christianity is therefore not between Jesus and Paul, as Buber, Beck and Flusser thought. Rather, the big councils of the 4th and the 5th century, Chalcedon, Nicaea, Ephesus, Constantinople, these big councils made the dogmatic Christianity possible. As Edward Schillebeeks wrote, with these councils, we witness a Greek concept of God, who is no longer related to human space and time, and a concept of man that is not biblical anymore. Like Buber, many Jewish scholars saw Paul as the first apostate, but a more accurate close reading of the authentic letters of Paul reveals that his Judaism was never relinquished, but was lived and valued as the source of a greater movement of atonement of Kapara, which included the entire world. Notwithstanding his criticism, Buber greatly contributed to the construction of an interreligious theology. His reflections on the importance of emunah, trust, formed the basis for any interreligious dialogue. In Buber's vision, Judaism could learn from Christianity and vice versa. Christians believe individually, but may learn from Jews to see the implications of their faith on the collective level. Likewise, Jews with their interest in the collective may learn from Christians that the individual is also important. Buber's remark at the end of Zweiglaubensweise is conducive of a real interreligious attitude in which one is open to learn new things from the other in the search for a good life in view of the ultimate reality. His dialogical interpersonal thinking may be applied to the ongoing conversation between people who belong to different religious groups. With his dialogical thoughts, he contributed to the appraisal of plurality of religions in relation to the eternal Tao. He paved the way to a new view in which all religions approach the transcendent or unutterable, about which all religions have so much to say. His meta-religiosity allows also for acceptance and criticism of religions that are all in exile and threatened by non-dialogical, gnostic, and magic elements. Religion is not God himself, and no believer is in possession of God's pure word. So time is going on, so I'm going to make briefly mention of the three other Jewish philosophers and see their contribution to the interreligious dialogue and to trans-different thinking. The second Jewish philosopher, I made research on Rosenzweig my entire life almost. In Rosenzweig's Stern der Lösung, 1921, the comment, thou shalt love, Vahafta, and the response, here I am, Hineni, are central. More than Buber, Rosenzweig paid attention to the institutional forms of religions. Judaism and Christianity were two authentic responses to the divine revelation. For him, Judaism stays in a dialectical, critical relationship with Christianity. The Bible was the Jewish Bible and the New Testament. He left the word and. Rosenzweig appreciated the conjunction and. As such, he stays at the beginning of a pluralized theology. He further contributed to the interreligious dialogue and theology in that he believed in translation as the readiness to share a common world. I quote from his book, Yehuda Levi. This is Rosenzweig. There is only one language. There is no peculiarity of one language that, even if only in dialect, childish speech, items, or of a particular class, cannot be detected, at least in embryo, in every other language. This essential unity of all languages and based on the commandment for all human beings to understand one another is what creates the possibility and also the task of translating. The possibility, the permissibility, and the obligation to translate. End of quotation. With their biblical translation, Bible translation, Buber and Rosenzweig brought a refined contribution to dialogical thinking and theology. The capacity of translating is one of the criteria for successful interreligious meeting and dialogue. The Verdeutschung der Schrift, with its demand to be heard by Jews as well as by Christians, is an eminent example of intercultural and interreligious dialogue. The translation brought the Jewish culture into interaction with the German one and contributed in this way to what I call trans-difference. And to a hermeneutics of the foreign, in which otherness and sameness come into dialogue. The difference of Jewish culture, strange to the German ear, was preserved in the translation. The particularity of the Hebrew world was not domesticated and absorbed in the German translation. Buber's and Rosenzweig's sensibility for the original word brought a change in perspective in the hearers of the biblical word. Gnostic spiritualization became impossible because the translation respected the materiality of the word. Buber's and Rosenzweig's method, in which alterity is preserved, remains vital for every conversation, especially for the interreligious one. In the first quarter of the preceding century, Rosenzweig came up with an exceptional view on Christianity. He courageously, and exceptionally one could say, put Christianity next to Judaism and defined it as a legitimate response to the divine revelation. In book one of part three, Judaism as a meta-historical task. In book two, Christianity is engaged in history. One may contest Rosenzweig's view on the division of labor between Jews and Christians in the process of redemption. But there is a complementarity between the two religions. Jews are the fire, Christians are the race. Christianity in the star is a way, whereas Jews have arrived. Such a view is, in my eyes, disputable. But it is constructive that Rosenzweig acknowledged both the Jewish and the Christian responses to divine revelation as legitimate. Rosenzweig's view on these twin religions is an example of pluralism that grants legitimacy to another religion. Unfortunately, Rosenzweig did not develop the same strategy for the dialogue with other religions. I could explain that, but that would take another lecture. Therefore, his account, Rosenzweig's account of the compatibility of two religions is only a start in view of the development of a dialogical theology that values the copula and in appreciation of the plurality of all religions. The two communities take part in divine truth, which is higher than the truth experienced by either of them separately. Rosenzweig describes how each community lives redemption differently. The intimate Jewish community lives eternity now, while the Christian missionary community involves itself in history and strives for eternity. He bases his thinking on Judaism with Christianity as its antipodic child, not by analyzing their respective faces, but by using a quasi-sociological description of both communities. Christians are eternally on the way, Jews are the eternal people, Am Olam. They are related in a critical complementary relationship. Christianity must always spread further. It must be missionary, just as it is necessary for Judaism to seal itself off. Begetting in Judaism is bearing witness for eternity. In Christianity, one bears witness in faith, which is faith in the way to eternity. The Christian faith is faith in something, while the Jew does not have faith in something because he himself incarnates faith. Jewish faith is the product of begetting. All this is Rosenzweig, of course. Rosenzweig plays here on the words Zeugnis and Erzeugen. On the eternal way, individuals are united by mutual action in the world. Ecclesia is therefore the assembly of individuals who bear testimony to Christ. A bond of brotherliness in the Lord unites people beyond difference of sex, age, class, and race. Rosenzweig did see Christianity as an important lifestyle next to the Jewish one and noted many parallels and differences between the two ways of life. Jews had a special function towards Christians, which consists in reminding Christians that they must not revert again in their previous pagan stage. Christianity illuminates the entire world. Jews, with their unity between nation and religion, remind the Christians that they are on their way. The synagogue looks prophetically into the future. The church always wants eternity, and yet Christians are much more linked to history. They have the task of bringing pagans in history to the one God and to vanquish their own paganism. They remind the Jews that they are not the only ones bringing redemption into the world. With this complex description of Jewish-Christian relationship, it becomes clear that Rosenzweig could not conceive of his own self as separate from the image of the other. Christians need Jews as their source. Jews need Christians as their race of their fire. Because of this interconnectedness, do you understand this argument? So if the race do not know about the fire, they are extinguished. But the fire has to know that there are race, that there is a dissemination, that there is dissemination into the entire world.
Can you repeat it again? Well,
yes. So Jews, yes, are the fire within the Star of David. They are the fire. And the Christians are the rays. So the rays, which are illuminating the world, they are rays which are linked to the fire. So without the fire, the rays will be extinguished. But the fire has to know that there are rays. So this is the complementarity for Rosenzweig between Judaism and Christianity. Because of the interconnectedness of religions, I consider Rosenzweig to be a forerunner of today's interreligious theology. He started the process of interreligiosity and appreciated the word "and." Buber situated Jesus in a series of humble servants of God, the Avdei Hashem, and unlike his friend Rosenzweig, explicitly highlight die highlighted the transcendence of Jesus as essential to the Christian view. I come now to the third, and I'm making it short now. Third Jewish thinker, Avraham Joshua Heschel. For Heschel, as for Buber, humanism, the struggle for human rights, we heard about it in this morning session, the struggle for human rights between people is a condition for religiosity. I quote from one of his lectures, any God who is mine, but not yours, any God concerned with me, but not with you, is an idol, unquote. Heschel was also critical of religion, which was part of the crisis itself in religiosity. I quote again, religion as an institution, the temple as an ultimate end, or in other words, religion for religion's sake is idolatry. The fact is that evil is integral to religion, not only to secularism. Parochial saintlessness may be an evasion of duty, an accommodation of selfishness. Religion is for God's sake. The human side of religion, its creeds, rituals, and institutions, is a way rather than the goal. The goal is, here comes the prophetic word, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God. When the human side of religion becomes the goal, injustice becomes the way. End of quotation. In encountering Cardinals Bea and Willebrands, and in meeting Pope Paul VI, Heschel would be far away in history. Heschel aimed to protest against the forced conversion of Jews and against the accusation of deicide, which has led to the loss of lives of many Jews. Prejudices had led to the cataclysm of the Shoah. Heschel wanted to help Christians to overcome their prejudices and start to perceive the intrinsic value of Judaism. With his prophetic conscience that sympathized with the divine pathos, he viewed his actions as tikkun olam, a reparation of the world. To humiliate another person was to humiliate God. This profoundly Jewish, I would say human and religious thought, motivated him to be active on several fronts. He got involved in the liberation of Jews from Russia, protested against the war in Vietnam, marched with Martin Luther King from Selma to Alabama for the rights of the black Americans, and helped Christians to do teshuvah. Heschel fought against all types of humiliation that were for him chilul Hashem, a profanation of the divine name. Against missionary tendencies, he insisted that the God of the Christians is the God whose covenant with the Jewish people was eternal and who did not regret his promises. Moreover, in order to preserve the eternal sparks in souls, he developed an inclusive thought in which Christianity and Judaism were inseparable partners. It is No Religion is an Island, originally, you know, a lecture delivered in the Union, Theological Union, 65, given to an audience of monotheistic people, the face of Abraham, Yitzchak and Yaakov, Heschel appreciated the plurality of religious expression. In his view, uniqueness and communication, the uniqueness of the religions and the communication, both together, they are compatible. Confronted with a worldview, with a worldwide ecumenical movement of nihilism, religious people are called upon to see humans as a disclosure of the divine, in human solidarity with and listening intensively to the prophets of Israel. For Heschel, religion is a means, not an end. He offers the perspective that no word is God's last ultimate statement. God's all-inclusiveness contradicts the exclusiveness of any particular religion. Consequently, humility, we heard about this morning, humility is inherent in authentic religious thinking. He calls it the secret test of faith. Of course, interfaith relations are neither compromised nor leveling down to the lowest common denominator. Neither is dialogue, dispute, or polemics. It has to do first and foremost with holiness, with the preparatio messianica, and no religion has the monopoly over that. Heschel was in contact with and gave advice to Cardinal Bea during the Second Vatican Council. He argued that Jews may maintain their own belief and transcend their own faith in openness to Christians, when could be autonomous and distinct, while at the same time fostering an openness to the non-Jewish world. Heschel lived the particularity of Judaism, yet he emphasized the hyphen in the expression Jewish-Christian tradition and the religiousness that Jews and Christians have in common. No religion is an island contains Heschel's thoughts on the necessity of fighting nihilism and cynicism as common concerns in a real ecumenical spirit. He speaks as a brand plucked from the fire. His destination was New York. Had it not been, it would have been Auschwitz or Treblinka. He conceives of the Shoah as a battle against the God of Abraham, a rebellion against the Bible. Jews and Christians are united by the fear of alienation from God and by the task of living in His presence. They both recognize the human as a disclosure of the divine. In Heschel's perspective, Nazism revived Teutonic paganism. Saving the radiance of the Hebrew Bible in the minds of men was at stake in the modern world. People must unite in mutual care and involvement in order to pay attention to God's pathos and to be sensitive to His presence. The task is to keep alive the divine sparks in the human souls and to experience in brotherhood, sisterhood, the fact that we are objects of God's concern. No religion can do that alone. Yet, also in Heschel's view, real dialogue is rare. He warned that if interfaith is not to lead to the confusion of the many, it must remain a prerogative of the few. After the Shoah, what is at stake is nothing less than the survival of holiness in the history of the Jews. That's Heschel. Now I come to the last philosopher, my teacher, Emmanuel Levinas, one of the biggest stars, not only philosophically, but also in his Jewish writings, a great Jew and a great philosopher. From Levinas, I learned that in meeting the other, one has first of all to be there for the other in non-indifference. His contribution to an inter-religious theology lies in his emphasis upon the alterity of the other. The alterity is not a cultural alterity, it's an ethical alterity. The ethical demand of the other as the absolute difference cannot be abolished. You understand what I'm about to say? For Levinas, the other has a call. From the face comes a call, and I can never entirely interiorize and neutralize this call, because this demand from the face of the other is infinite. I'm in contact with God through this ethical call, and that's the alterity of the other. The infinite demand from the face as the other of the other ruptures my own totality. In this relational thinking, the I is here I am, hineni, the one for the other. In Totality and Infinity, 1961, Levinas reflects on the possibility of a relationship based upon recognition of the exteriority and alterity of the other without awaiting reciprocity. The meaning of the face is thou shalt not kill, lo tirzach. The ethical infinite commandment from the other urges one to answer. In a later book, Otherwise Than Being, 74, Levinas goes a step further. The primary structure of subjectivity is responsibility. I quote, the identity of the same in the ego comes to it despite itself from the outside as an election or an inspiration. in the form of the uniqueness of someone assigned. End of quotation. Levinas describes subjectivity itself in ethical terms. Responsibility is not a mere attribute of subjectivity. Subjectivity is initially for the other. Levinas' contribution to interreligious theology as welcoming of the religious other cannot be underestimated. In Totality and Infinity, he proposes to call religion, and I quote now, it's a strange definition of relation, it's the bond that is established between the same and the other without constituting totality. That's a great definition of religion. It's the relationship between the same and the other without totality. That's religion. Without totalizing the alterity or neutralizing the alterity of the other in the sameness of the I. In welcoming the other, the glory of the infinite is glorified. In his Difficult Freedom, 1963, Levinas defines the ethical relationship as religiosity, and I quote, "Ethics is not the corollary of the vision of God. It is that very vision. In the holy ark from which the voice of God is heard by Moses, there are only the tablets of the law. The knowledge of God, the knowledge of God which we can have and which is expressed, according to Maimonides, in the form of negative attributes, receives a positive meaning from the moral God is merciful, which means be merciful like him. The attributes of God are given not in the indicative, but in the imperative. The knowledge of God comes to us like a commandment, a mitzvah. To know God is to know what must be done." End of quotation. For Levinas, relationship is only possible on the basis of the recognition of the other's exteriority or alterity. The difference or transcendence of the other is not to be totalized in the same. In Levinas' footsteps, God may be conceived in terms of infinity, urging to act and answer the call of the other. Consequently, dialogical theology may be defined as a wisdom that discusses a normative element, namely the uniqueness of each and every human being who asks to be listened to, honored, and respected for God's glory. I come now to the conclusion. After Nostra Aetate, Christian churches changed their attitude toward Jews. It is a landmark document that brought about a Copernican revolution in the Catholic Church and promotes the dialogue between Jews and Christians, Jews and Catholics. There were always such dialogues, but after the Shoah, the Church dispensed with her negative attitude towards Jews and Judaism. For a long time, the Church had forgotten that Jesus was a Jew. After the Shoah, which showed the relation between the anti-Judaism of centuries and racial and state anti-Semitism, the Church no longer defined its own identity on the negative background of the Jewish religion, but began to shape this identity in connection with Judaism. The Church repented and expressed remorse for the injustice inflicted to Jews. She atoned for all that had led, in the phrasing of Elie Wiesel, to the death of Christianity in the Shoah. Most of the Jews acclaim these positive steps in Catholic Church. Since a few decades now, synagogues have become again very attractive for many Christians. As in the time of Chrysostom, who in his Kata Judaion gave recourse to his theological outrage against Christians who continue to visit the synagogue in order to enhance their spiritual life. There is today a will in the Catholic Church to understand the Jewish people as they understand themselves. One becomes conscious that the Hebrew Bible is polyinterpretable and that there is a rich Jewish reading of Mikra. One is more and more conscious that Jesus was not an Italian, but the Jew of Galilee who lived according to the Torah. there is recognition that the New Testament originated in a Jewish milieu and that it is the result of the Jewish culture. This trend leads to a rejection of a theology of substitution because of its exclusivism and the recognition of the Jewish people as they live today. It's not enough to recognize the legitimacy of Judaism before Christ. Jews remain Jews also after Christ, post Christum natum. By now, one has to take into account that Jewish words as law, or better, by now, one has taken into account that Jewish words as law and commandment are not easily integrated into the thought of the church. But more time is needed for the church in order to get rid of antithetical positions. More broadly, I doubt if Jews and Christians have yet ceased to shape their own identity on the negative background of religious others. The described radical changes of the church did not escape the attention of Jews, who thought that these changes deserve appreciation. This led to the document Dabru Emet, Speak Truth, published September 2000 in the New York Times. More than 200 Jewish scholars and rabbis signed the text. Clearly, the document highlights the common ground between Jews and Christians and wants cooperation between Jews and Christians as partners. On the occasion of the 50th anniversary of Nostra Aetate, prominent Orthodox rabbis from Israel, Europe, and the States issued a statement in which they affirmed that Christianity is, I quote, the willed divine outcome and gift to the nations, end of quotation. Nostra Aetate and the Jewish reactions upon it are only documents, but these are positive steps. It will depend upon the concrete and positive acts of Jews and Christians alike if they want God's presence in the world. Jews and Catholics are on their way, and their imperfect religions do not have the last word, which finally belongs to God. We Jews are not yet Or Lagoyim, light to the nations. And Christians have not yet realized the final redemption. No one can bring the kingdom of God alone. We are on our way. There is much to do in the two communities and much to learn from each other. An interreligious theology serves the dialogue between people who remain different. I come back to this image. It is the intellectual account, interreligious theology is the intellectual account of interreligious and intercultural meetings and discusses a multiplicity of aspects in transdifference. Transdifference is the possibility of making connections and contact with others, of communicating and bridging, notwithstanding differences, but thanks to them. In transdifference, one recognizes the particular and rises above it. By failing to open oneself up to the other's understanding of the ultimate, one may miss an aspect of religiosity that is relevant to one's own life. As the 13th century Persian Sufi Jalal al-Din Muhammad Rumi said, the lamps are different, but the light is one. Thank you.
It's very interesting that when you discussed the Bubel, Rosenzweig, Heschel, and the conclusion, it started from, I don't know, the attitude was historical, starting from war, coercion, power, cruelty, to more tolerance. But it's not, this movement was not only between Jews and Christians, between Protestants and Catholics after the Hundred Years' War, like say, Vietnam War, the use of violence, the use of war. So we understand perfectly well why you shouldn't kill each other over religion. Okay, it's not, religion is not made to kill people. But I don't think you can base a dialogue on the assumption you don't kill the other person. The thing is, I don't know that unless in university level with budgets, the science tries to kill humanities. But it doesn't mean that there is a dialogue between the science and the humanities. You have competition, you have bad feelings because you share the same space, you think that one excludes the other maybe, but say no, we all live in peace, we are all all have the rights to our understanding. This is not a dialogue atmosphere, it's an atmosphere that really, I don't care so much about what you believe if you leave me alone. And I don't think this is a basis for a good dialogue. And then when you came to your conclusion, I think it went to something else, that the dialogue was necessary. So it's not only that science and humanities will not destroy each other, they can learn from one another. So what can they learn from one another? This I did not get at all.
Okay. Now, in the teachings and writings of these four dialogical Jewish philosophers, they have all a basic concept of the I, which is an I in relation. The I in itself is, according to these philosophers, a mental construct. It doesn't exist. So if you start with this anthropological viewpoint, that the I is the I for the other, the one for the other, l'un pour l'autre, Levinas says, then you have you start to construct a kind of theology which can develop into an interreligious theology, because we are all human beings. Dibra Torah, Keshon Bnei Adam, the Torah speaks in the human language, and that is true for every religion. It always speaks in the human language. So if other religions have this other languages, this human languages, I can certainly learn from their viewpoint, their vantage point, upon the ultimate. Meaning, I can learn how they organize their lives. If I am an I in dialogue, if I am an I which is not an isolated monad, then I have the possibility to see that I can leave my own bubble and be in contact with others. What can I learn from others? How they realize their relationship with the unutterable, about which one speaks so much, but nobody has a monopoly of speech about God. I even think that a kind of apophansis could also relate bring religions together.
Would you say the same thing about Hindus?
Oh, yes.
They also have deities, many deities, but we should learn how they organize their lives. So the dialogue, yes. Jewish-Christian dialogue, you think, could be the same thing like the Jewish-Hindu dialogue?
But I think that we have to learn that the different religions are, so to say, God's will. Meaning I say, kivyachol, so to say. Because I was during years teaching in Hamburg, co-teaching with Hindus, with Buddhists, with Alevites, with Muslims, with Christians. And I tell you, there is a real possibility of enriching your life, your spiritual life, by being in contact with others. Because we can love our own love story, but we also can be open to the way other people construct their religious narrative, how they also have their love story with, call it God, the ultimate Brahman, Allah, Nirvana, whatever, the transcendent element is there, and there are different approaches to it. So why would I restrict myself to one specific viewpoint if I know that I live in a world in which there is a variety, a multicolored garment of Yosef, our brother?
Alexander. So there might be two arguments or two things I could see. First of all, with Jews and Christians, we have the same ground we stand upon. We have the
For
same
sure.
texts we read together. So there is some bond which goes beyond all the others. And my second question, of course, is my challenge is not Hindus and Buddhists. My challenge are secular people
exactly.
all around.
So,
how would you deal with that? In your transdifference concept,
I think one has to put secular people, atheists, next to religious people, all the entire variety. Because what is important in the interreligious theology I developed now almost 10 years is not the thought-centered theology, but the deed-centered theology. And in this deed-centered philosophy, the emet is not a truth, an abstract truth. It's something to be done. Emet has to do with amen. And amen is the steadfastness, the trust. And this amen makes it possible to interpret this quotation of the psalm, emet mi eretz tzmach. The truth springs from the earth, meaning it's from beneath. We don't know what is the divine truth, but it blossoms between us, between the human beings, and it's not only in one community, but in very different communities. And of course, in monotheistic communities, we have a special relationship.
That's so when Abraham left, actually he shouldn't have left. He should have stayed where he was and kept quiet and sell idols. You know, continuing.
In
the job of his father.
Yeah, no, he is, on the contrary, he has to leave because he has to become the father of many nations. And he has to be, and in fact, he is the father of very different children. But the tragedy of these children is that they didn't understand each other during centuries. And I think the father would be pleased to have a more relaxed relationship with others, with other children. So I think the Abrahamic move is the move out of the same, and move out of what is familiar, because to be in touch with transcendence is to leave your own narrowness, as we say, Mitzrayim. You come out of Egypt, of your own Egypt. You come out of that. In outreaching to the other human beings. What Buber says so beautiful is that we are human beings who are called to be mitmensch, a neighbor man, not a neighbor mensch, says Cohen, Hermann Cohen, but a mitmensch. So Buber says we have to be a zwischenmensch, we have to be a man between, your kind of glue between the human beings. And what is religiosity other than this glue, being the bridge between the pontifex, between human beings? That is perhaps a novel definition of religion.
So obviously that should be the starting point of all this bridge-making work, not pontificating. that would mean something different in English. but rather this genuine bridge-making among people is the very idea at the beginning, right, of our common text, that we are all made after the image of God. Even atheists They just don't realize that yet. But if they, if we live among them and with them in dialogue with something more than mere tolerance, right? To tolerate someone is basically just to their capability of bearing the slings and arrows of coexistence, right? That is not enough, obviously, for Jenna. But with genuine goodwill, love, and understanding, if that is the platform, then this bridge-making and communication is absolutely possible.
And I'm very grateful for this remark because, of course, an exclusivist viewpoint would be problematic, but also an inclusivist viewpoint is problematic because you think that you are better than the others in formulating things.
It's
still a hierarchical. So it's right.
So being together with the other. Generally.
Yeah, right.
It's not cannibalizing.
It's right. Yeah, right. And then you have a third possibility is that you are more pluralist. But I'm going beyond. I'm going beyond pluralism. Because I do not think it's enough to respect the otherness of the other. Mm. I think it's. I'm not a liberal in that way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a philosopher who tries to think about what religion could be in our times, and this goes beyond the mere liberal live and let live. It's this interreligious theology is based upon a praxis, of course, but a praxis in which there is a real interchange. And it's a transformational process. You cannot enter into a dialogue without changing, and without changing yourself. It would be
a genuine living together as opposed to just living next to each other.
That's it.
And just to add to that picture, which is a beautiful beautiful illustration of the idea, it was the very same idea behind the stained window glasses of cathedrals. That is the one common light that enlightens the entire picture, which can, however, be the entire picture if it consists of so many different colors sharing in the perfection of the unified white light. Right? So that is the exact same idea. That is just realized in a different type of architecture, which just proves the same point, right?
Yeah, thank you for
again.
That. Yes.
Do we have time? It's 4:31.
So we should stop.
Thank you. I like very much the way in which you enacted your focus on the between, insofar as you identified in your criticism how Buber, it appears, did not move out of the familiar enough, insofar he was familiar with I, thou, I, it, and there's a reading of Paul where that familiar category doesn't work, and you're citing Amy Jill Levine and others. But I'm wondering when you showed how Jesus and Paul were not so opposed, you did mention almost in passing the suggestion that it was the councils that created a block. Mm-hmm. Nicaea, Chalcedon, Constantinople, Ephesus, and so forth. You didn't go further than that. You spoke of Hellenizing Christianity. Now, in moving outside the familiar, how would you imagine that contact in Christians and Jews moving outside the familiar went so far as Catholics will confess every Sunday, I believe in one God, Father, mm-hmm. the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver in life, of life. I mean, how is moving out of the familiar on both ends going to address those
mm-hmm. I think that Buber was certainly wrong mm-hmm. when he described Paul as an heretical because Paul wanted the Jews to be Jews. When he is anti-Jewish, so to say, then it is only for the goyim who took upon themselves the mitzvot. And they don't have to do it, because they are going. they are not Jews. But for the Jews, that is a different way. So, so Buber was not right.
Right.
Now, I quoted Edward Schillebeek, the Flemish Dutch theologian, whom I knew personally, because he says this Hellenistic anthropology and Hellenistic view of God is not anymore Jewish. Okay. And therefore, I said Christianity starts in the 4th or the 5th century with Schillebeek. But I think that one can go and must go a step further. Because what is a good interreligious hermeneutics? It's an hermeneutics in which you try to understand the other in a way that he or she loves to be understood.
Right.
And I understand that Christians talk about the Trinity. So I have no problem at all with accepting this otherness. Because this is the way people are defining themselves, and I have to, not only that I have to honor that, I can with my relational philosophy and theology even give the Christians arguments how to understand the interrelatedness between elements in the divinity.
Okay, so the move by Schillebeck is also dissatisfying for you because it kind of like says we shouldn't go any further because that's Hellenizing. No, you want to have that conversation.
Yeah, I want to have the conversation with the utmost openness that there are other people whose thinking is not reducible to what I think. It's what is called openness. But we are not there. We are far away from it. By the way, a last remark, if I may. I was privileged to have a review of my book on interreligious theology as 2015 by Peter Berger, the famous sociologist of religion. And he was positive about my book, and we met each other several times, and he had one caveat, and we didn't discuss that. He said, there are limits to dialogue, and the limits are when there is violence. You can't have a dialogue when there is violence. And he said, he's a very humorful person, it's perhaps a good way to close this session. He says, imagine that there are some Aztec theologians from Mesoamerica, pre-Columbian Mesoamerica, and they are descendant of this Aztec people. And imagine that the World Council of Churches in Geneva invites these people, and they say, we are very glad to welcome you to this convention of the World Council of Churches here in Geneva, and we will be very glad to hear about how it is possible that the gods want the human sacrifices. Thank you so much for coming. So that would be, of course, a very problematic thing. So that means that our dialogue is a lefty thing. It's a lefty thing. It's a rare thing. It's not occurring mainly when it is between officials, persons. It's a very superficial thing. But it can be a really transforming thing. A transforming thing. And bring an openness which, until now, because we have this identitary fixations, we did not enough see that, conceive that, bring that into the discussion. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So we have a short break of 15 minutes. We have.